Hi, my name is Gary Perks. I'll be your instructor this summer for EE112, which is a first circuits class. And in a first circuits class like this, I think the best place to start is with a discussion on electrical charge. Electrical charge surrounds us, and in fact, it is us. So I'd like to start with this question: where do you find the particles of electrical charge? This is something that you most likely first talked about somewhere along the line in high school. So hopefully you answered inside an atom. That's where you find the electrons and the protons, which are our electrical charge particles. Now, also in high school physics, I'm sure you also talked about how all matter is made up of atoms. So I have this question, and that's, well, if all matter is made of atoms, and atoms contain the particles of electrical charge, then why doesn't all matter exhibit electricity? In other words, why doesn't all matter spark, tingle, or glow? Well, hopefully you recall that the reason that's so is because, well, most matter in its natural state has the same number of electrons as positive charge. So there's a balance, and the material is naturally electrically neutral. See, in order to have evidence of electricity, in order to have a spark, tingle, or glow, you need a separation or an imbalance of charge. And one example of that is a chemical battery like this. This is a 9-volt chemical battery that I'm sure you've all seen. And a chemical battery like this uses chemical energy to separate electrical charge. The terminal that we label the minus terminal has excess electrons on it, and the terminal that we label the plus terminal has excess positive charge. So now, and I'm sure you've all done this at one time in your life, where to check this battery, you can just hold it up to your tongue, and that tingle, well, that's evidence of electricity, and that was due to the separation of charge that's across the terminals. Another example that you've probably experienced is, you know, if you have a wool sweater, let's say, and you rub your hand in that wool sweater, and then you go up to something conductive like a piece of metal and touch it, well, you'll feel that little spark that occurs between your fingers and the metal. And that was due to friction, the action of friction separating charge from the wool sweater onto your skin, and therefore giving your skin excess charge. So electrical charge is important in circuits. In fact, there's several properties of electrical charge that are important to know that are listed here. First of all, electrical charge is conserved. So just like energy, electrical charge can neither be created nor destroyed. This is actually a basis behind a very important circuit law that we'll get to later on in the class. Also from physics, you may recall that unlike charges have an attractive force between them, like charges have a repulsive force between them. The unit of electrical charge is the coulomb. 1 coulomb, as you can see, is equal to a whole bunch of electrons. It's a really big number here. And then 1 single electron has this amount of charge here, a very small amount of coulombs. In fact, 1 coulomb is just the total charge of this many electrons. So if you take this number of electrons times the amount of charge on a single electron, well, it comes out to 1, and that's what we call a coulomb, okay, again, which is the unit of electrical charge. Now, perhaps more interesting than electrical charge's existence is when you put electrical charge in motion. Because electrical charge in motion is called current. Okay, so as you can see, there's a derivative relationship between current and charge. So dQ dt is equal to current. Right? It's just coulombs per second. The unit of current, the ampere, is just equal to charge per time, so coulomb per second. Likewise, you can determine what the charge is by integrating current over a time interval, some initial time to some time t. And we'll actually do some examples in the next video of both of these, okay, derivative as well as integration. Now, in order for current to flow, you need to satisfy two conditions. One is you need an energy source. So, as I showed you earlier, this chemical battery, this is an energy source. This is actually called a DC energy source. DC stands for direct current, as we'll talk about also coming up later in the course, that direct current DC is when current flows one direction in a circuit. There's also sources which are AC, which stands for alternating current, where the current alternates direction periodically, but that's actually a topic for your second circuits class. We won't discuss anything but DC circuits in 112. But in addition to the energy source, you need a second condition, and that's a closed path. A closed path is some conductive medium between the two terminals or the two ends of the source. So right now, just this 9-volt battery with no closed path, no sort of medium between the two terminals, electrical medium, well, there's no current flowing from this battery right now. However, if I put my tongue to the terminals like I did earlier, and as I'll do again, well, that little tingle through my tongue, that's the current that I sense. Those are the charges moving through my tongue, and it was my tongue that provided an electrical path, a conductive medium between the terminals. Okay, so you need both of these conditions. Okay, just one won't do it. You need both. And then, lastly here, before we end this this particular video, there's two ways to look at current flow through a conductor such as copper, so such as a copper wire or a copper trace on a printed circuit board. You can either view the current as a movement of electrons, or you can look at the current as the movement of the absence of an electron, which is a positive charge. Also, often we use the analogy between current and water. Just like water is a continuous movement of water molecules, well, current is a continuous movement of charge. So I have the following here, picture, which hopefully illustrates how you can view current in two different ways. So what you see in this diagram here is, you know, these lines here are the borders of either a copper trace or a copper wire. These atoms here would be copper atoms. So if the electrons are flowing in one direction, and what this diagram shows is the electrons flowing left to right. Okay, you can see here that this electron leaves its valence orbit, and then another electron comes in and fills that void, and then another electron fills this void, and so on. So the electrons are going left to right. Well, as an electron leaves its valence orbit, it leaves a hole, you know, which is the absence of the particle, which has an equal and opposite charge, an equal positive charge. And the basis behind that an equal positive charge has to be left in the wake of the electron that exits is conservation of charge, that the net effect of this transition here has to be zero. Otherwise, it would violate the conservation of charge, that you'd either have the creation or destruction of charge. So as an electron leaves, in its absence, it leaves a positive charge. So as this electron leaves, it leaves a positive charge, then a nearby electron will fill that hole, which in its absence leaves a positive charge. This electron will fill that hole, which leaves a hole here. This electron fills it, which leaves a hole here. So as the electrons are going one direction, which is left to right in this diagram, the positive charges are going the other direction, which would be right to left. So what's important to realize is that it's only one current, but there's two different ways to view You can either view the actual particle that's moving, which is the electron, or you can view the absence of the electron, okay, which are called holes, which are going the opposite direction. And you'll see in this class, in any circuits class that you take, we always define current as the movement of positive charge flow, which is called conventional flow. Sometimes, or a lot of times, at least in my experience, I've seen in physics books, they use electron flow. Electronic technicians view current as movement of electrons. But engineering texts in any circuits books that I've ever seen written for EEs and CPEs, it always defines current as the movement of positive charge, okay, which is conventional charge flow. One more additional thing I want to show you here before we end this video, and that's just this here that I found in an old book that I had laying around, and this just shows, you know, range of current. And you can see, as I said at the beginning of this video, charge is us. We contain atoms, so, you know, we're made up of electrical charge. So, you know, the nerve cell in our brains, this is the amount of current that flows in our brains. It's a very small amount, 10 to the minus 12, you know, that's pico, so pico amps. But you can also see some other common items here in the amount of current, such as computer memory, nano amps, typical integrated circuit, IC, you know, milliamps. Threshold of sensation, so when I put that battery to my tongue, there was probably, you know, a couple milliamps that was thrown through my tongue. That's why I sensed that tingle. And then it doesn't take much current to be fatal to humans. You know, just a tenth of an amp, 100 milliamps, taking a path through a person's heart can cause their heart to stop. So it's, you know, relatively, you know, not that much current. And then you can see the rest here. So this just gives you an idea of the range of current, some common items you're probably familiar with. Okay, well, the next video we'll do a few examples, you know, relating current to charge. So we'll be doing some calculus, taking a derivative to get current from charge, and doing an integration to get charge from current.